UBC cancels Andy No talk on Antifa violence due to violent threats from Antifa. Well, I think you've accomplished the goal of what your event was going to be about, and you didn't even have to do anything. You see, Andy No is going to come and talk about how violent Antifa is. People then prepare to come, they set their schedules, and then the event gets canceled due to threats of violence. Congratulations, your point has been made, we can all go home. Thanks for hanging out, next segment will be coming up in a few minutes. I'm kidding, I'll stop here. Okay, let me get serious for a second. I gotta say this. I think it's funny, the paradox of this story. But I do want to say something else. At this point, I'm kind of more offended by the people who let their events get canceled than by, you know, the events being canceled in the first place by Antifa. Let me explain. I'll read you the story and we'll talk about it. Because it is BS that Andy's event got canceled. But I'll tell you this, man. You know they're going to do it. Come on. I put an event last year. Okay, I say last year. It's funny, but it was like 4 months ago. And Antifa threatened to burn down the theater. We got a backup venue. And we carried on. Now that we did face setbacks. We lost half of our seats and we had to issue a bunch of refunds. So we would have sold more. There were more people, but the event went off. We had a really great venue. We did it at this casino in Philly. It was awesome. The theater backed down and they're pathetic for it. And you know, whatever, fine. The point is, if you're going to put an event, period, okay, in the political space, challenging Antifa, you got to have a contingency plan. So look, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me, right? If you're going to do the event, you better have a plan, because at a certain point, I'm going to blame you for it. Now, look, I'm not a victim blamer. You know, get all the left all angry. I get it. Antifa's violent. They don't like Andy No because he calls them out with evidence. And that's a threat to their activism, so they really don't like him. But come on, guys. Get a backup plan going. At least you do get the paradoxical point being made. This headline is glorious, by the way. Andy No talk on Antifa violence canceled due to violent threats from Antifa. Bravo, good sirs. You've created like some, it's a great headline. And they didn't make it up. It's actually what happened. But let me read and we'll talk a little bit about this. They say, headed into 2020, the University of British Columbia is still struggling to balance free speech with safety concerns posed by Antifa-linked groups who threaten violent protests against speakers they object to on ideological grounds. The post-millennial editor-at-large, Andy No, had his speaking event canceled at UBC after safety concerns due to potential violent protests from Antifa groups. No's scheduled presentation, ironically titled Understanding Antifa Violence, was scheduled to take place on January 29th at UBC's Robson Square in downtown Vancouver. Conservative legal advocacy group and Justice Center for Constitutional Freedoms has issued a press release and legal demand letter on behalf of student group The Free Speech Club, demanding that UBC reinstate the event. So we'll see if it happens. I guess that's at least some kind of backup plan. According to the letter, the Free Speech Club received a phone call on December 20th from Ron Holton, chief risk officer at UBC, stating, "The reason for the cancellation is the concern about the safety and security of our campus community. The JCCF points out that no specific concern was mentioned." The press release states, "The Free Speech Club and UBC confirmed the Andy No event booking with a contract on November 25th, 2019, and had paid the campus booking fee." I'll stop you right there. We did our event. We booked it, confirmed in March, and were assured protests would not be an issue. They said, "Oh, we've had protests here before. Ann Coulter spoke at the same event." Yet they got one serious threat, and all of a sudden they were like, "Get out." Okay? They had Ann Coulter. It's like, you can't, but a bunch of like moderates and liberals and centrists have a conversation? Apparently not. But we had our contract for months. So I'll tell you this right now, guys, if you're putting on an event, make it explicit in the contract. They cannot cancel for any reason, okay? There should be like limited exemptions. So I say any reason, but let me clarify. It should be like, in the event the building is incapacitated, you know, the building is shut down due to fire, due to collapse or something, do not let, like, explicitly outline, they will not back down due to threats from protesters. Okay, and then you deal with the security issue. You say, "We will fund security. You cannot cancel this in the event of protests or you know, veiled threats online or anything like that." That is something they should be acceptable. Because I'll tell you this, when we did the event, we were assured by the people, "Don't worry, we've had protests before. It's not a big deal." And we said, "Great, that's why we chose the venue," and it wasn't in the contract. So we learned our lesson. Okay, the contract actually protected us and we went through it and it was clear, but they're still refusing. So I can't get into too much because of, you know, legal stuff in the background, but I will say that, okay? You got to double down on these venues. They can't cancel because Antifa's not going to do anything. In the legal letter, the JCCF says that canceling the event signals automatic acquiescence to the heckler's veto, which will embolden threats from those who oppose the very notion of free expression. Citing UBC's own statement of academic freedom, the letter addressed to UBC President Santa Ono threatens legal action against the university if the event is not reinstated by January 10th, 2020. Normally, when a speaker's presence has caused concerns for safety for either the speaker or attendees, event hosts are asked for additional security fee. The amount is assessed by the university. The groups organizing protests have never, to public knowledge, been asked to pay security fees. In this case, the event was canceled with no contingency. Another event at UBC, featuring feminism critic and professor of literature, Janice Fiamenga, was canceled, then rescheduled, due to concerns of violence and policing issues. Let me tell you something, man. It's what we all know. I'm tired of talking about it. It's getting quite frustrating. It's Antifa who are the ones who are shutting down events, threatening people on a regular basis, not the far right. There are weird sporadic instances of extreme violence from fringe actors that people call far right. I'm saying people call because their ideologies tend to be rather different, okay? Not because I'm trying to deny they're not far right. I'm just saying they're different people for different reasons that are called far right. Yet, for some reason, this happens all the time, and I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why it's so simple. CNN's not going to run a story about this. The local news in Philly ran stories about what had happened with our event getting canceled, but CNN won't. In the event of a high-profile fringe lunatic doing something nuts, CNN and every outlet screeches about it all day and night, and that's because it's a high-profile incident. The severity of the incident caused it to become very high-profile. So you have very, very few of these far-right, you know, lone wolf, or whatever you want to call it, instances, and you have consistent and regular harassment and violence from Antifa. But I'll put it this way. If Antifa whacks someone over the head with a club, it doesn't make national news. When Andy Ngo got attacked, it did because of the severity, but also because he's a journalist and the media couldn't ignore it. So Brian Stelter over on CNN gave it a blurb. It's not like they dedicated a large segment to it. This sparked a larger national conversation that Antifa absolutely hated, and so they've taken it out on Andy Ngo ever since then. He's getting it way worse than I ever got, and I rag on Antifa all the time. So what you end up seeing is a consistent and low-grade hum. People tolerate the hum, right? I'm talking about like the fringe far-right element instances are screeches, really loud spikes where people are like, ah, you know, and it's like it shocks you and it makes you angry. And then everyone talks about, what was that noise? What was that? Oh, we heard that. And then with Antifa, it's this low-grade hum where people are just used to it. It's like, oh, that hum's always been there. Nobody talks about it. It's not breaking national news when Antifa goes around, you know, 800 times in 1 year bashing skulls because each individual moment isn't enough for anyone to care about. But one every other year or a couple in a year, or, you know, we had that far left guy and the far right guy back to back in that 1 week. Those things make the press. But then I'll tell you this, for whatever reason, you tell me, when that dude in Ohio did his, you know, committed this tragedy, he was a lefty. He was a socialist. And it doesn't make the narrative. Okay, because it all falls into like, what are we going to do about the Second Amendment? So I think the issue is, as I explained, Antifa does this all the time. And because the media doesn't cover it when it happens, people don't care when it happens. There's no fear that UBC will be punished in any way because no one's going to talk about it. And that brings me to the next bit. Do you think UBC is concerned about Andy Ngo showing up with a horde of black clad individuals with crowbars and Molotov cocktails? Of course they're not. He was denouncing it. So who do you think they're going to side with? Not the guy who's being peaceful and trying to have a conversation. The people who are threatening to smash out their windows. They're going to say, hey, you know, we're going to side with the violent ones because we're scared of them. And welcome to the real world. South Park had this really great episode where they talked about how terror works. And Comedy Central censors the whole thing just a long beep, like just nonstop. And it's hilarious that they did that. And apparently you can find the full speech online, but they say like, you know, South Park does that. Today I learned something, or they used to. It's like, I learned something today that, you know, threats of fear and violence actually work. And then Chef is like, that's right, kids, terror works. And here it is. So they're right when they say that the heckler's veto encourages more. Because guess what? It's worked every single time for Antifa. Antifa has had no problem doing this. When I was putting on my event out here in Philly, people were calling local businesses who didn't even know what the event was. And I got to listen in some of the phone calls. It was quite hilarious. People saying things like, I heard you're having a far right event. It's like, we're not. Well, I heard on the internet that's, we're not. I'm sorry. I'm not sure who you're referring to. Well, I don't know who's there, but someone said it. Where do you live, sir? I live in San Francisco. Why are you calling Philadelphia? You don't live here. My favorite was one guy who called a local business and said, if you don't cancel this, I will never come to your place of business again. And the store owner was like, where do you live? And they were like, California? It's like, dude, you've never been here. You'll never be here. I don't care what you think. Have a nice day. Yet this is what you get. Some random person from Russia could be calling and they would fall for it. So I'll keep this one short. It's been a really mind-numbing and frustrating day because YouTube censorship has gotten to the point where I can barely work. Maybe I'll quit. I don't care. I'm sick and tired of this. You know what I mean? Like I've said a million times, I'll get my van, just take off. I'll make a show about skateboarding or something. What's the point? You know, I'm trying to do the best that I can. That's why there's a reason why I have two channels, because YouTube is literally suppressing my main channel. Free speech. How about that? So whatever. I'll end with this. Okay. Andy, do another event. Have a plan B. Book two venues. Okay. List your address. And then at the last minute, send an email to everybody, or don't post the address. Like Mike Cernovich did that. He said, you will know what the address is the day of the event. You know why? Because then they can't call in threats. What they do is the 11th hour tactic. What they did to us was we had the event public because we really didn't think it would happen. And at the last minute, like a week before, they started bombarding the theater with threats. So don't release the address until the day of. Tell people which town to come to, but don't tell them where the event is. That way no one can call in threats. And then on the day of, if they do, it's too late. Can't do anything about it. Stick around. The censored segment from Tim Pool is coming up next at 6:30 on youtube.com/timcastnews. I'll see you there.